for Jesus. Let's shout for the Lord. Let's shout for Jesus. He is our reward. He is our praise. He is our song. We lift our voice. We raise our voice.
Hello and welcome to the Seventh-day Sabbath, the Holy Impact Ministries.com production. I'm Pastor Scott Delane. God bless you and thank you for sharing your time with us here today. And thank you for keeping God's seventh-day Sabbath, a day that He said would be a perpetual agreement for all generations, a sign between Him and His people. God bless you, and thank you, you guys, for hanging in there. I know we had some people that were in the chat room, and it just was not working out. We were doing anything and everything that we possibly could. We had done some updates, Windows updates, to our computer system, and I think that may have something to do with what caused all of this havoc that we were having this evening. Certainly unexpected, and my apologies to you guys. Thank you so much for hanging around with us. It's just so good to know that we've got good friends out there that love us and that are hanging in there, and I just want to thank you so very much for doing that. It was just one of those things, just didn't seem to want to work out. Again, I think it might have something to do with the updates that we did to the system, and we may need to reboot or something like that to try and get it going. We tried everything. We have other devices that were plugged into the modem, and we tried unplugging those, and we just tried anything and everything we could. We refreshed the modem box. We turned it off, restarted it up, did everything we could. Just could not get the signal to perform for us. We'll probably be calling the cable man to come out here and see if he can fix some of this stuff and get us back up and running. But in the meantime, God bless you guys. Thank you so much. Again, Brother Nelson, we saw you in the room there. God bless you, brother. Thank you for hanging in there with us. And so many other people that were trying to hear the message this evening, this Shabbat. And it just didn't work out. But again, my apologies for that. We're working on getting that corrected, and we will continue to work on it. Probably we'll start Sunday morning, probably give the cable guy a call Monday. We'll see if we can't get him out here to get that fixed so that next Shabbat we don't have this problem again. But with all that being said, God bless you guys. Thank you again for joining us. We have a couple of things I just wanted to kind of go through with you. This Shabbat is such a beautiful Shabbat here in the great state of Ohio. It was like almost 60 degrees or better here in the great state of Ohio. Sun was shining, spring in the air, beautiful, beautiful time. And so we are certainly enjoying that for sure. And we hope that you also are enjoying these things as well. God sent us plenty of rain yesterday, and it rained all day. And I was very thankful for that. You know, we need that life-giving rain so very badly. And so many people, like the folks up in Flint, Michigan, up there with all that poison water that they've got going, what a mess that is. And it was good to have some fresh rain coming down upon us. So we give thanks for that when it rains. But today was a beautiful day, absolutely beautiful. But at any rate, I just wanted to talk. We have had so many problems this week. Our website, Holy Impact Ministries website, went down, and I didn't even have any idea. I went to put up a notice that we would be live this Shabbat at 9 o'clock Friday evening, and the website wasn't there, so it was down. So we had that was apparently had something to do with the server. It wasn't able to access the money from the bank or something happened. They had an error somewhere or something, so I had to contact them. And I had to get that squared away and this website back up so that I could post what I wanted to post on the Holy Impact Ministries website. So we have just been bombarded by things this week, but we are back up and we are running. We're just pre-recording this right now. We're going to boost this up to you as soon as we can, so that you have this to look at for Shabbat. And a couple of other things I wanted to talk about. Very quickly was our Bible study that we finished the book of Romans 14 and 15, chapters 14 and 15, and it was no longer, gosh, maybe 24 hours. since we just did that Bible study, and wouldn't you know it, I was listening to a pastor again proclaiming that the Sabbath was done away with, and it didn't matter which day that you kept the Sabbath. And he was pointing to Romans 14:5. Romans chapter 14:5, and we just got done talking about that. And it just absolutely breaks my heart to hear these pastors doing these kinds of things. But again, Romans 14:5, I just wanted to kind of go back over that very quickly with you. For those of you who had not seen that last verse, and you may get this yourself, because it is what they always use, Romans 14:5. Let's go there and just take a look at Romans 14:5 very quickly. This whole chapter of Romans 14, for those of you who don't know, is all about food and fasting. It has nothing to do with doing as thou please or thou wilt or changing God's Sabbath. And we're just going to show you this here today. The verse that they will always use is Romans 14, chapter 5. And listen to what it says here. It's in red. It says, one person esteems one day better than another, while another esteems all days alike. Each one should be fully convinced in his own mind. And so they assume, by taking this candy stick scripture out of context and just plucking it out of Romans chapter 14, out of Paul's letter to the Romans, that this gives them license to just go ahead and just profane God's Sabbaths and to change them around, do whatever they want to do. And this is so very clear. This chapter is about fasting and food. If they would just read the next sentence, let's read the next sentence. Let's read these two sentences together, Romans 14, 5 and 6. Let's read them. It says, one person esteems one day as better than another, while another esteems all days alike. Each one should be fully convinced in his own mind. The one who observes the day observes it in honor of the Lord. The one who eats, eats in honor of the Lord, since he gives thanks to God, while the one who abstains, abstains in honor of the Lord and gives thanks to God. Very clearly, this is about fasting. And the whole chapter from 14, if you read the whole chapter all the way down, it starts out, and you can see, I highlighted in blue, eats only vegetables. He may eat anything. He who eats, who eats? Who eats is down here again. Who eats? You go down farther. What does it say? By what you eat, eating and drinking, for the sake of food. Eat meat, drink wine, if he eats, eating. So you can see, and I did that on purpose, so that you can see that the whole context of the whole verse is about eating and fasting, and that's what it's about. Some people were wanting to fast on one day. The Pharisees and the scribes were the men who were always overriding the laws of Yahweh God the Father, constantly, and they were putting their own spin on what you had to do and what you didn't have to do. And this is why the Messiah was so upset with them in chapter 23 and in other verses. Because they were trying to berate his apostles for not washing their hands. Well, washing their hands is not in the Torah. That's not a law of God. That's the law of the Pharisees, you see. So that's when Yeshua tells him, he says, you know, you've done a fine job of making void the word of God in order to hold on to your own traditions. You know, you chastise people for things that are not even in the Torah. And he was so upset with them because they were preaching and teaching these things that were not in the Torah anywhere. And I tell you, we got a lot of pastors and priests that are out there right now, modern-day scribes and Pharisees, that are doing the exact same thing. And this is just one proof of the pudding, you might say, when they try to use Romans 14:5 to say that it has something to do with the Sabbath. Now, you can read this chapter and clearly see the first four verses are about food and eating, and then all of a sudden Romans 14:5, he's just going to change gears and talk about the Sabbath. I mean, nonsense. It's just nonsense. It doesn't even make any sense. If they would read 14:5 and 14:6 together, it would give them some idea of the proper context of this sentence. But this is what we're up against. This is the battle, the ignorance that we are up against. And this was a pastor who came out of seminary school. So again, we've got all of these pastors who are trained up but they're trained up according to their denominational doctrine. What their charter of men says to teach is what they teach and preach. And he was taught that this has to do with the Sabbath. It does not. And it's very clear. I think anybody with a little bit of God-given common sense can know this has nothing to do with, you can just choose whatever day you like to have as the seventh-day Sabbath. How outlandish is that? And for someone that is going to be standing in front of maybe hundreds of people teaching and preaching this nonsense. But there were other ones that he used too, but this one just caught me off guard. Made me kind of had to laugh if it wasn't so serious, because this is what they do. And this is the battle that we're in all the time. And in fact, this made me so outraged and so angry that he was preaching and teaching this, that I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to take clips of these pastors saying these things on the next, each seventh-day Sabbath. We're going to take a little clip of a pastor preaching and teaching something that's not true, and we're going to go to the Bible, and we're going to look in our scripture, and we're going to throw that to the ground so that no one is deceived by those things. So, because it's important to take a little bit of time to know what the enemy is saying and what they're preaching and teaching and what the actual scripture reads and says. And that's important for us to do and to keep in the proper context. So I think we're going to do a little bit of that each time. We'll take a little clip or we'll take something that they're using out of context, and I'll play that, let you listen to it, and then we'll go look at it to verify that what we have comes from the Word of God. And it is so important. You've got to read the whole book, and that's imperative. And you would think someone coming out of seminary school would have read the whole book, but again, it's just like the Bible says, they are forever studying, forever reading, and never understanding. And that's exactly what is going on with some of these folks. But with all that being said, I wanted to talk a little bit about the greatest commandment. And this all ties in, of course. What is the greatest commandment? And this is something that I think is very profound, and I think many, many, many Christians, if you ask a lot of Christians, they don't even know what the greatest commandment is, which is shocking to me. It shocks me when I say, do you know what the greatest commandment is? And a Christian, professing Christian, says, thou shalt not steal or something, you know, and they just kind of wing it and guess, you know, what the greatest commandment is. They don't know. This is the milk of God's word. This is kindergarten, childishness, you know, the very beginning steps to know what the greatest commandment of Yahweh God the Father is. And so I just wanted to kind of touch on this a little bit and kind of go through some of these things and connect some of the wires together here. Let's take a look at, I think I have this bookmarked here. Yes, Matthew 22:36. Now, this is when the apostles asked. Now, most of you probably already know this stuff. There might be some things that we go through here that you don't know, though. So I'm going to kind of try and tie this all together. So stick with me on this. This is where the apostles asked Yeshua the Messiah. They said, which is the greatest commandment in the law? And what does he say? He says, and he said to them, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment. And the second is like it, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Now, where did he get this? Is this something that Yeshua just made up? Did he just grab this out of the air? No, he did not. In fact, we can find that in Deuteronomy. Let's go take a look at the book of Deuteronomy 6:5. What does it say? You shall love the Lord your God with what? All your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. This is where he was quoting from Deuteronomy. And again, my friends, it is so important for us to know and to understand most of Paul's writing, most of Yeshua, what he said, was actually quoted from, taken from the Torah. And this is a perfect example. Again, here you find it. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. And these words I command to you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children, and you shall talk of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand. They shall be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on your doorposts of your houses and on your gates. So this is extremely important for us to know and to understand. Our Messiah wasn't teaching anything new. In fact, most of what he said really didn't have anything new in it. What he came to do is to do away with the penalty of the law. Even the disciples, even the apostles rather, did not understand that until they actually did it. They didn't understand what was happening to them. They didn't understand why they took the Messiah. They weren't expecting any of this. They were even shocked. And you can see the perplexity in them after he is gone and that he's been put in the tomb, and they are just frightened and have no idea what to think at that point. And they are very perplexed. So it's very interesting when you read through these scriptures and you see them. And boy, can you imagine the predicament that they thought they were in? And here they have the Romans and the Pharisees and the Sanhedrin, all who just got done killing Yeshua. So they're obviously going to come after those apostles as well, and they knew that. So they're running and hiding in any little nook and cranny that they can, just kind of trying to stay out of the main stream of things until Yeshua makes himself present again. What a great story that is. What a great story that is. And we have the Passover coming up, and we're going to be talking a little bit about that as well. But as for today, I just kind of want to stick on this theme, the greatest commandment. The greatest commandment is that we should love the Lord our God with all our mind, all our strength, and all our soul. Our Messiah said very clearly, he said, "He who loves mother or father more than me is not worthy of me. He who loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me." Same thing that is part of the greatest commandment, to love God first, to love him with all your heart, mind, and strength. And again, the reason for that is because he cannot protect us if we do not love him first. We'll always be listening to that unbelieving wife or that unbelieving son or that unbelieving daughter. We'll always be giving them our ear and always be listening to them because we love them more than we love Yahweh, God the Father. So the only way that he can protect us is if we love him first. And it's just so important that we realize the air that we breathe, the ground that we stand on, belongs to him. It does not belong to us. All of these things, when we walk outside and we see the sun, we see a beautiful day, or even if we see the rain coming down to nourish the earth, these things are given to us by Yahweh God the Father. These things are not ours. They don't belong to ours. We did not create them. He did. And we are created in his image. Who gave us our mother? Who gave us our father? Who gave us our son and our daughter? It was him. So again, it's not too much, I don't believe, to ask that Yahweh would say, love me first. Love me with all your mind, all your strength, and all your soul, and I can protect you if you will love me first. Just love me first. And this is so very, very important for us to know. So, and the next question then begs, once you understand that as a Christian, is we need to know and to understand. So how do we love God then? How do we love God with all our mind, strength, and all our soul? How do we do that? Is loving God just saying that I love God? Is it praying and just saying, I love you, God, I love you, God? Is it simply a matter of professing with your mouth that he is the true God, the father of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob? Is that how we love God? Is it just a feeling, a tingling that we have in our heart? We just know we love God. Is that all what there is? Is that all there is to loving God? Is it a tear-filled moment in time that we experience and then we just forget the next day? Is it coming down to the front of the aisle in front of a lot of people and confessing that Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, is the Messiah? Is that how we love God with all our mind, all our soul? Is that all we have to do? Is that it? Is it praying three times a day like the Muslims do? Or five times a day? Or seven times a day? How about 10 times a day? Is that loving God with all our mind, all our soul, and all our strength? These are questions that we need to ask ourselves. What does the Scripture say? And how does the Scripture say that we should love God? Now, for those of you who have been with us at holyimpactministries.com, you know right where I'm going. And because I don't think we ever have a session where we're together. We don't say this. But let's go there for those folks that are new. We're going to go to, I have this bookmarked here in the number 3 here. This is going to be 1 John 5:3. For this, we know that we love the children of God when we love God and when we obey his commandments. And right here it is in red, my friends. This is the biblical definition of the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. For everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world except the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God, Yahweh? Who is it that overcomes the world? You see, you cannot overcome the world without the Holy Spirit of God. And you can't get the Holy Spirit of God without first believing in the Son of God, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ. And it's so important for us to know and understand that this is how we love God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. Now, we've been working through the book of Romans, and we see Paul proclaiming time and time and time and time again that the law of God actually still stands. But then in another sense, he'll say, well, you know, if you're under the law, you're under a curse. So he confuses people. Again, we know Peter in 2 Peter 3:16 gives that warning. The writings of Paul are hard to understand. And boy, are they. They are so difficult to understand. If you don't keep them in the right context, if you don't know who his enemies were, if you don't know who the crowd was, the circumcision group that was battering him, if you didn't know that these Pharisees that Yeshua had to deal with, Paul also has to deal with, and he's got to shake them out of the law, the ordinance of the law. And we're going to talk a little bit about that, and I think we're going to show some things, I think, that will help everybody understand the separation of the law from faith. And that's what so much of Christianity today believes, is that there is the law is dead. And that's not what Paul was saying. Paul was simply saying that you can't obey the law separate and apart from faith. And he also, he has a different mindset. We're going to talk a little bit about that as we go. But I want to stick on exactly this love of God, because this really opens things up, and I think it will open the minds up of people that are having a hard time understanding that the laws of God still are written in our hearts. They still mean something. They're really not a law anymore, because in order to have a law, you have to have a penalty, and there's no penalty. We're going to talk a little bit about that now. Right now, they are commandments. They're not law, because there's no penalty necessarily if you break them. It's been taken away. Our Messiah was a propitiation for our sins, and he did away with the penalty of the law. So if a law doesn't have a penalty, it really can't be a law anymore. What you're left with are the commandments of God. That's what you're left with, is the commandments. And that's why John tells us, for this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. Well, what are his commandments? They are what was known as his law. That back when it was a law, when you had a penalty, that's what they are. That's what his commandments are. And that's very clear, and Paul makes that very evident. In fact, let's take a look at what we looked at in our Bible study. I just want to pull this up for you very quickly. A lot of you guys have already seen this, but again, these are just some of the things that Paul proclaims through the book of Romans. And we looked at this before. And I'm just going to drill them through. Here's chapter 2, chapter 3, chapter 6, chapter 7, chapter 8. I just took these out as we went along, and just a couple of different scriptures out of every few chapters to show what Paul said about the law. He said, for it's not the hearers of the law who are righteous before God, but the doers of the law who will be justified. Romans 2:13. Romans 3:31. Do we then overthrow the law by this faith? By no means. On the contrary, we uphold the law. He says in Romans 6:1, what shall we say then? Are we to continue sin that grace may abound? He says, by no means. Now, what is sin? Sin is the transgression of the law. So obviously the law is still there. So otherwise you couldn't sin. So he says, by no means. He says, how can we who died to sin still live in it? Romans 7:12, he says, so the law is holy. God says, or not God, but Paul says that the law is holy in Romans 7:12. And he says that the commandment is holy and righteous and good. And he really locks it down pretty good here in Romans 8 again. He says, for the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. So if you're of the carnal mind, a fleshly mind, then you're hostile to God. Why? Because the carnal, fleshly mind does not submit to the laws of God. Indeed, it can't. So those who are in the flesh cannot please God, very, very clearly. And Romans 8, 2 is where he really locks down what Yeshua came to die for. He says, for the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. Not from the law, from the law of sin and death, which was the penalty of the law. And that's what the law of the Spirit of life has set you free from in Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, our Messiah. So I just wanted to kind of get that up there and put that in front of you, just in case there's someone here who has not seen that Bible study. And I want to urge you to go to check out our Bible study on the book of Romans to know and understand a little bit about who Paul was, where he came from, know that he was a Benjamite, know that he spoke three languages, know how intelligent he was, know that it indeed did take Yeshua knocking him off his horse and striking him blind to get him to finally know and understand who he was. Even with all of his great intelligence that Paul had, he still didn't understand until the Messiah knocked him off his horse and struck him blind. So, and I find that so in step with what is going on today. We have these men who can speak different languages, and they're very schooled, and they're educated in Plato and Socrates and Aristotle and eschatology and etymology and hermeneutics and all of these things, and they can't understand what Romans 4, chapter 14 is about. Ay. It is a mixed up, crazy world that we live in, my friends. And our adversary is doing anything and everything he can to confuse, if it were possible, even the very elect. So let's continue on here. So we know, we can know, and we can understand exactly what it is. Let's look at Luke 6:46. And I think I have that bookmarked here in the fourth. There we go. Luke 6:46. He says, why do you call me Lord? This is the Messiah, again, red letter words. He says, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and not do what I tell you? He says, everyone who comes to me and hears my words and does them, I will show you what he is like. He is like a man building a house who dug deep and laid his foundation on the rock. And the flood came and arose, and the stream broke against that house, and it did not shake it, because it was built on the rock. But the one who hears and does not do my words, okay, and does not do them, is like a man who built his house on the ground without a foundation. And the stream broke against it, and immediately it fell, and the ruin of that house was great. Again, we must build our house on the rock. This Bible, these scriptures are the rock. And these red letter words that we're looking at right here, this is the rock, nothing else, no doctrine of men, no doctrine or theology of some charter of men that comes out of some denomination. And we need to know this and understand this. Let's take a look at Matthew 15:8, and I have that here as well. I just wanted to kind of show this to you, run through this. Matthew 15:8 says, this people honors me with their lips, he says. This is our Messiah speaking right here, Matthew 15:8. This people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men. And that's exactly what we're doing today. With Christmas, that's a commandment of men. It's not a commandment of Yahweh God at all. We have Easter, we have Good Friday, not a commandment of God. It is a commandment of men. And it's in all our history books. We really don't have to look that far to know these things. But yet people all day long will just not bother. They just don't want to take the time to know these things and to understand these things. They would rather listen to some guy that they barely know on the wrong day of the week preach from the back half of the book while programming them not to read the first half of the book, and take these candy stick scriptures out of context and change them and twist them and bind them around into all kinds of lasciviousness. And this is what we're trying to fight against. This is the fight. This is the fight. And again, we are fighting not against flesh and blood so much as we are principalities in high places, my friends. And we need to remember that. When they can fool even the very elect, even the very scholarly, even the very astute, men who have been studying for years and still don't get it, forever studying but never understanding. This is very powerful. This is a very powerful kind of Gnosticism that men have joined themselves at the hip with our adversary, Hasatan the devil. And they don't even know it. They don't even know it. And they will fight to the death trying to tell you that God's Sabbath no longer matters and you don't have to keep it and we're once saved, always saved, and this is a dispensational state of grace that we're living in and you're going to be rescued by the pre-tribulation rescue. It's coming up. Don't worry about it. Things get bad. You're going to be taken away because God loves you more than he loved his son, more than he loved the apostles, more than he loved the prophets, who were all murdered, all persecuted. But he loves you more, you see. It's all about God is love and love is God. And we don't have to do anything because Jesus did it all for us at the cross. This is not the love of God. This is not the love of God. This is a lie. This is heresy, my friends. And we need to know it. We just need to absolutely know it. This people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. Why? Because they keep the doctrines and the commandments of men and not my commandments. Let's look at John 15:10. We can take a look at that very quickly here. Let's take a look at that. John 15:10. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. This is what we've been trying to say the whole time. And we repeat this over and over and over again. In Matthew 5:17, our Messiah says, I did not come to abolish the law or the prophets. I came to fulfill them. I came to do them. And I want you to do them too. I want you to follow me. What does he say in John 5:10? If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. It's all about keeping the commandments, which are no longer a law. They're just commandments. He said, look, these are my commandments. He says, they were a law, and if you didn't obey them, there was a punishment. Okay, I've taken the punishment away now. So it's not a law anymore. It's just my commandments. They're just my commandments. You know what I want you to do. Now, you either love me enough to do them, or you don't. And that's what our Father is saying. It's just very, very clear. Let's continue on. He says, these things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. So it's not just him that he wants us to love, but it's each other as well. But we must tell each other the truth. We must help people to understand what Yeshua is trying to say. What does it say in the Word of God, in the Scriptures? We've been given that, and it's our responsibility now to share this information with our brothers. Now, we have people that will not listen, and they will say that you're a heretic, and you're trying to be a Jew, and you're legalistic. Oh, we've heard it all. We've heard it all. And it just it hurts us in the heart, not because they're saying these things to us. We joy because of these things, because the Bible tells us when you're persecuted, know that you're saving treasure up in heaven. Your reward is great. So we don't mind that they're saying these things to us, but what breaks our heart is the idea that they're lost, and you just can't get through to them. No matter how long you talk, no matter how hard you try, everything that you do is geared towards helping them to understand, and they just will not. And it is heart-wrenching, and you understand what Elijah was feeling when he was pleading with God. He says, Father, he says, look, you know, they've killed all your prophets. He says they reject you at every turn. They're even trying to kill me, he says. You know, and what did Yahweh tell him? He says, don't worry, Elijah. He says, I have a remnant. I have a remnant that has not bowed the knee to Baal. And so he always has that remnant of people that he keeps. He always has those people that are keeping the faith, contending for the faith, and refuse to bow the knee to Baal and these other gods and these other idols and these other ideas and these other theologies and what have you. And it is so very important to know that he does have his remnant. There'll always be a remnant of people. He promised that Israel would be his people and he would be their God. And he is keeping good on that promise. And that promise will be fulfilled and is being fulfilled even now as we speak. Let's go ahead and take a look at Deuteronomy 10:15. I think I have that bookmarked as well real quick. Let's take a look at this. He says, "Yet the Lord set his heart in love on your fathers and chose their offspring after them, you above all people, as you are this day." He says, now listen to what he says in Deuteronomy 10:16, because this really gives us insight as to how God wanted it from the beginning. How did Yahweh want it from the beginning? He says to the Israelites in Deuteronomy in the Torah, "Circumcise therefore the foreskin of your heart." Of your heart. He was always after their heart. He just wanted them to love him. "Circumcise therefore the foreskin of your heart and no longer be stubborn," he says. No longer be stubborn. Stop being so stiff-necked. Stop it. Stop it. He says, "Circumcise therefore the foreskin of your heart." He says, and we'll get back to this in just a moment in the New Testament, because we'll see a connection there as well. He says, "For the Lord your God is God of gods and Lord of lords, the great, the mighty, and the awesome God, who is not partial and takes no bribe. He executes justice for the fatherless and the widow and loves the sojourner, giving him food and clothing. Love the sojourner. Therefore, for you were sojourners in the land of Egypt. You shall fear the Lord your God. You shall serve him and hold fast to him, and by his name you shall swear." You shall swear. Now, this is an extremely profound piece of scripture that we find in the book of Deuteronomy when we compare that to the book of Romans. Let's go take a look at the book of Romans, chapter 9, verse 30, in the book of Romans. And I think I have that bookmarked here. And there it is, 9:30. And we're going to just go through this section right down here at the bottom that's blue here. And we're going to start right here at Romans 9:30. "What shall we say then?" This is Paul speaking now. He says that Gentiles who did not pursue righteousness have attained it, that it is a righteousness that is by faith, but that Israel who pursued the law that would lead to righteousness did not succeed in reaching the law. Why? Listen to what he says here. "Because they did not pursue it by faith, but as if it were based on works." This is exactly what Paul is saying. This is what God wanted from the very beginning. What did we just see in Deuteronomy? You know, "Circumcise the foreskin of your hearts." He wanted your hearts. He wanted you to keep his laws by faith because they were his commandments and because they loved him. That's why he wanted them to keep his commandments, but they rather kept them as though they were based on works and that they were earning something, and they completely misunderstood what it was that Yahweh God that was trying to tell them, and they kept whoring after other idols and whoring after other gods and going to witches like the witch of Endor and all of these other kinds of things that Solomon did, and David looking at Bathsheba on the roof, and I mean, they just time and time again. These were just earthly men. They were men just like you and me, men and women, just like we are. And they made these horrible fleshly mistakes, and they kept tripping all over themselves. And one of the reasons that they did this is because they didn't have the love of God in their heart. And now we see David, and even King David, how many times did he go against God? How many times did he mess up? Time and time again. But the difference with David is when he messed up, he genuinely came before the Lord God and he repented, and Yahweh knew it was in his heart. I mean, he wouldn't eat for days. He would cover himself in ashes and sackcloth, and he would starve him. He was so sickened at what he had done. He didn't even realize what he had done. When he finally did realize it, he repented, and he knew that Yahweh God's laws meant something to him. They broke his heart that he did this. He was tricked into this by Hasatan the devil, and this lust of the flesh had led him astray. And Yahweh God knew. That's why David was a man after God's own heart, because he understood how to keep God's laws written in his heart. Was he perfect? No, he wasn't perfect. He screwed up time and time again. He screwed up. But he knew how to repent, and he knew how to ask for forgiveness, and he knew how to turn away from that sin and don't do it again. And that is the most important thing. You know, it is said that there is really not much difference between a wise man and a fool. Both the wise man and the fool make mistakes. The difference is that the wise man doesn't keep tripping over the same mistake time and time again like the fool does. And this is the true difference between a wise man and a fool. It's not that the wise man doesn't make mistakes too. It's just that the wise man doesn't return to make the same mistakes again and again and again. And we can stop that, and we can be like that and be like the wise man if we have the love of God in our hearts. If we know what God wants us to do, and these things mean something to us, and we're concentrating on these things rather than on football games and basketball games and American Idol and video games and soap operas and sitcoms and all of this trash and garbage. If we're concentrating and we're concerned with what Yahweh wants us to do, how he wants us to walk, studying his word to better understand it, being able to fend off those who are in deception and help others to understand, I mean, this is the battle that we're in. This is the battle that we're in. And our adversary has made it so comfortable for us. And we've said this many times. It's like God's people are sitting in a jail cell with the door wide open. And the devil knows that he doesn't even have to shut and lock that door because we are so comfortable in our sin. And we just don't even want to know the truth. We are just fed these things. It's like a mind vault of some kind. It's something that has a, it's, what am I looking for? I can never think of that. Where they take over your mind. And they're just reprogramming you with all of this garbage that you keep hearing over and over and over again. And they keep using the same candy stick scriptures to convince you. And we just keep buying it because we don't read the Bible for ourselves to know. This is the love of God, that we read the word of Scripture, that we obey the Scripture, that we study to show ourselves approved, rightly dividing the word. This is what we're supposed to be doing. Take a little bit of time away from the basketball, away from the football, away from the video games, away from the sitcoms, away from the soap operas, away from 2.5 Men and American Idol, and study the word of God a little bit. And study it and read it. And this is what we need to do. And this is what the world needs to do. Because we've gotten so far away from it that it is frightening. You know, I was watching a video not very long ago. In fact, just earlier today, I was watching a video where these men were having their congregation drink gasoline. I'm not kidding you. I am not kidding you. They are having their congregation drink gasoline. Just all kinds of things. People coming up and just flipping out all over the place, running up and down the aisles, jumping over each other, doing all kinds of crazy, disorderly things, just anything and everything, full of demons. And you can see they're just full of demons. And these guys up there in their three-piece suit and their leather-bound Bible just rebuking all of these demons and doing all of it. It is insane what they are doing. Now there are pastors who believe that it's okay to reach into a woman's blouse and to feel her breast. This is part of their sermon that they do. This was a very disturbing video. Very disturbing video. There are so many of these videos out there, and many of these pastors and so-called pastors are doing these things. It's just doctrines of men. They're doing whatever they want to do. There was one church where they had the women actually get completely naked down by the beach and bend over at the beach and bow down at the beach to try to attract husbands from the congregation. This is a video. I was going to post it in our church history video, but it was so offensive that I decided against it. You can find it. It's on YouTube, and it's actually going around right now. But they show these different churches where, and these are actually different churches that these people are going to and doing these things, incredible things. And most of mainstream Christianity isn't quite that wild and quite that crazy yet, but this is what it leads to. This is what it leads to. It leads to a free-for-all. I can do as thou wilt. I can do with anything I want. And these pastors that are doing these things are rich. They're rich. I mean, they're driving big black Denalis, flying around in their personal jets, and all of these other kinds of things. People are giving them money, believing that they can really cast out demons. And what does the Bible say? Many people are going to come to me and say, Lord, Lord, haven't we cast out demons in your name? Haven't we done many mighty miracles in your name? Haven't we done all these things? And what's he going to say? Exactly right. I never knew you. That's exactly what he's going to say. And you never knew me. Get out of here. Just get out of here. Just get away from me, you who are lawless, you who are full of iniquity. Get out of here. And he's just going to send them away. Can you imagine that? People thinking that they've been serving Yahweh and Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ the Messiah, only to find out that he says, I don't even know who you are, and you certainly don't know who I am. Get out of here. That's going to be a rude awakening for a lot of people, my friends. And in fact, I had a woman this week tell me on a Facebook post, she says, I've cast out legion, and I've saved people, and I've done this, that, and the other. And I just wrote her back, and I said, honey, I said, you don't have the authority to cast out legion or any other demon. Only he does. And the fact that you're telling me that you have the power to do these things tells me right now that you're a false prophet. You need to go home. You need to read your Bible and your scripture. And you need to be careful before you wind up possessed. And some of these people just need to be told. They need to be rebuked sharply. This woman actually told me that this week. She didn't like... we were talking about presidential candidates, and this came up, and she was trying to tell me how powerful that she was, and she casted out legion. Of course, she got that from the New Testament when Yeshua came to cast out the demons out of the pigs. That's where she got that. He said, what's your name? He said, we are legion because we are many. But at any rate, people will always take those things, and it's how the devil works. He mixes a little bit of truth with or a lot of truth with a little bit of lie. And that's always the way he works. Again, that's the coffee analogy. You guys have probably heard that. I won't go through that again. I'll wait till later to tell that. I think you guys remember the coffee analogy. But at any rate, let's continue on with our study here then. Let's see here. From the very beginning, God intended for his laws to be written on the hearts of his people. Let's take a look at Genesis 12:3. I think I have that bookmarked here. Yep, here it is. It says this, in the very beginning, in the very first book of the Bible, he says, I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you, I will curse. And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. He's talking about Abraham now. Okay, he's talking about Abraham. Let's move on to Genesis 26:4 and see what he says. 26:4, he says, I will multiply your offspring as the stars of heaven, and I will give to your offspring all these lands. This is the promise of Abraham, my friends. This is it. He says, and in your offspring, remember there's no S there, offspring, all the nations of the earth shall be blessed. Because why? And this is so important for us to know. Why did he choose this uncircumcised Gentile by the name, he was an Assyrian, by the name of Abraham? Why did he choose Abraham? He tells us in Genesis 26:5, you should highlight this in your Bible. It says, because Abraham obeyed my voice, he kept my charge, my commandments, my statutes, and my laws. This is why Yahweh God the Father chose Abraham. And it says right here, let's read it again, 26:4 and 5 together. He says, I will multiply your offspring as the stars of heaven and will give to your offspring all these lands, and in your offspring all the nations of the earth shall be blessed. Because Abraham obeyed my voice, kept my charge, my commandments, my statutes, and my laws. Okay, clearly God Yahweh tells us why it was that he selected Abraham. And this is important for us to know and to understand as well. Let's take a look at Genesis 12:6 very, very quickly. Genesis 12:6, he says, Abraham passed through the land to the place at Shechem, to the oak of Moreh. At that time, the Canaanites were in the land. Then the Lord appeared to Abraham and said, to your offspring, not offsprings, to your offspring, he said, I will give this land. So he built there an altar to the Lord who had appeared to him. Now we're going to talk about this offspring. What is this offspring? Okay, let's talk about this here now. Let's go to Galatians 3:18. I want to go over to Galatians. Let me skip down here. 3 and 18. Now listen to what he says here. And here it is. And we're going to go down to 23. So we're going to go down right through here. Okay, he says, for if the inheritance, this is Paul speaking in the book of Galatians, New Testament, Brit Hadashah, he says, for if the inheritance comes by the law, it no longer comes by promise. But God gave it to Abraham by a promise. Why then the law? It was added because of transgression until the offspring should come to whom the promise had been made. Okay, now who was the offspring? The offspring was Yeshua HaMashiach. That's who the offspring was. And it's important for us to know and to understand this. It says, for the inheritance comes by the law, it no longer comes by promise, but God gave it to Abraham by a promise. Why then the law? It was added because of transgressions until the offspring should come. Okay, until the offspring should come, to whom the promise had been made. And it was put in place through angels by an intermediary. Now, who is that offspring? It tells us right here in Galatians 3:16. He says, now the promises were made to Abraham and his offspring. It does not say, and to offsprings. Notice these two words here, offspring. It does not say offsprings, Paul says, referring to many, but referring to one, and to your offspring, who is Christ. So we know who that offspring is that he's talking about here in Galatians 3:19. It's Yeshua. It is Yeshua. So he says, why the law then? He said, it was added because of transgressions until the offspring should come, to whom the promise had been made. He made that promise to Yeshua, is who he made it to. And it was put in place through angels by an intermediary. Now, an intermediary implies more than one, but God is one. Is the law then contrary to the promise of God? Certainly not. For if the law had been given that would give life, then righteousness would be indeed by the law. Now, what is righteousness? Righteousness is keeping the commandments of Yahweh God, the Father. Now, it's no longer law. Why? Because there's no more penalty. So you can't call it a law anymore. It's simply the commandments of Yahweh is what they are. Okay. He says, but the scripture imprisoned everything under sin so that the promise of faith in Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, might be given to those who believe. He says, now, before faith came, we were held captive under the law because you had that penalty, right? So you were under the law, imprisoned until the coming faith would be revealed. So then, the law was our guardian until Christ came in order that we might be justified by faith. Now, again, what does faith have? Faith has the obedience of faith. Let's take a look at that very quickly. Faith. What is faith? We already know this. If you took the study course on the book of Romans with us, faith is the love of God, according to Matthew 22:37. Faith bears fruit, according to 1 John 2:4. There is an obedience to faith, according to 1 John 5:3, and faith upholds the law, according to Romans 3:31, according to Paul. So all of these other things are outside of faith. Continuing to sin, you don't have faith. If you're still stealing, you don't have faith. If you're not obedient, you don't have faith. If you're into homosexuality, you don't have faith. If you don't believe, of course, you don't have faith. Do as thou wilt, to do as thou will teaching, then you certainly don't have faith. Faith has obedience. It bears fruit. It is the love of God, and it upholds the law according to the scriptures. Important for us to know this and important for us to understand these things. If we study the Word of God, we already know this and what Paul's talking about here when he says justified by faith. But now that faith has come, we are no longer under a guardian. For in Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, you are all sons of God through faith. Okay? Now again, faith and the love of God what is the love of God? 1 John 5:3, for this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. So they're not work to us. They're not burdensome. And here's where he really nails it all together for us. He says, for as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is no male and female, for you are all one in Christ. All one in the Messiah. And Galatians 3:29, here comes the big kicker. And if you are Christ's, then you are Abraham's offspring and heirs according to the promise, because you are in Christ, who the promise was given to. He, Christ, what did it just tell us here in Galatians? Paul told us he is the offspring that was prophesied about back in the book of Genesis. He's the offspring of Abraham this promise was made to. So if we're in Christ, then we are Abraham's offspring and we're heirs according to that promise. Why? Because we're in Christ. We're in Yeshua HaMashiach, the Messiah. See how nice and neatly this all fits together if we just read the whole book. If we just read the whole book. And there are, of course, there are many, many other scriptures that nail this down as well. But we can know and we can understand this if we will just take a look at what he's talking about. And again, the law. And I like to explain the law as speed limits on a street. Okay, the speed limit out in front of this in my house is like, I think it's 25 miles an hour. Okay, so they have a speed limit law. It's 25 miles an hour. And if I break the speed limit law, I have to pay that penalty. That penalty may be a fine or maybe whatever it is, depending how fast I'm going and if I hurt anybody. But there's a penalty for that, for breaking that speed limit law. Okay? Now, if that law, the penalty of that law was taken away, okay, that speed limit law, now there's no more penalty for breaking the speed limit. That's not a law anymore. It's just a commandment. So now the commandment is from say, the police department or whoever makes the commandments. In our case, it's Yahweh God the Father. He's taken the place of the police officers here. But they say, okay, we're just going to command you not to go more than 25 miles an hour. Okay? So we're going to command you not to go any more than 25 miles an hour. So what does that do? Some of us will understand that commandment. It's 25 miles an hour because there are children playing. This is a residential area. It's not safe for people to go faster than 25 miles an hour. And that's the commandment. We're going to respect that commandment because we know that it's right and it's just and it's good. And then you're going to have other people who aren't going to care about that commandment. And they're going to come zipping through here at 50, 60 miles an hour. There's no penalty. They don't care. And so they're going to do as they please. They're the do as thou wilt professing Christians, you see. They will always just ignore those commandments and say, I can do as I please. And that, my friends, is the difference between a true Christian who loves God and knows what the greatest commandment is, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and soul, and that for the love of God is that we keep his commandments and they're not burdensome for us. That's a true Christian. A professing Christian who says, I'm a Christian, I'm a Christian, I'm a Christian, because I believe, okay? And that's all he thinks that he has to do. That's the difference. We keep the commandment, okay? Not because it's a law, because there's a penalty under there, but because it's a commandment. We respect that, and we know we love our brothers, and we know that we want to protect our children, so we're going to obey it. The other guy, the professing Christian, doesn't care. All he's looking for is a way out, and he wants to drive as fast as he wants, when he wants, how he wants, and he doesn't care if there's kids playing in the road or in the neighborhood. He just doesn't care. But he says that he believes. And that's the difference. It's kind of an analogy that you can kind of use to help people to know and to understand. A law isn't a law if it doesn't have a penalty. So you can't call it a law anymore if there's no penalty for that law. Now it is simply a commandment. Yahweh God the Father says, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. And that's just very, very simple. If you love me, you'll keep my commandments. And what did he say he did with his in the new covenant? We can find that in Jeremiah 31:31, and we can find it in the book of Hebrews chapter 10. What does he say? He says, I will write my laws in their hearts and in their minds. We already know that. Now, we've studied that many, many times. But for those of you who are new and don't know these things, it all comes together. If you read the whole book, you really got to read the whole book. You got to know exactly what it says. And again, for those of you who do not know, let's take a look here at 1 John 5:2. Let me go there. 1 John 5:2. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. Also ties right in with Romans 8:6. Let's look at that. Romans 8:6. And it says very clearly, Romans 8:6. He says this. He says, for to set the mind on the flesh. We're going to go down to Romans 8:8 in the dark blue here. This is Paul. He says, for to set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the spirit is life and peace. For the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. Why is it hostile to God? For it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot, because it's set on the flesh. So those who are in the flesh cannot please God. How much more plainly could Paul have, put it? It's just right there in your face, right there. The carnal mind, the fleshly mind, does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it can't. And that's why those that are in the flesh cannot please God. Now, if you're in the faith, you are then filled with the Holy Spirit of Yahweh God the Father and Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ. He says, I will not leave you. I will come to you, and we will make our dwelling within you, is what Yeshua tells us. And we know that. Those of us who know the scripture and who have been walking with him, we know. We look for ways to please God. We don't look for ways to get out of it. We look forward to the Sabbath. We look forward to the Passover. We look forward to first fruits. We look forward to the Feast of Unleavened Bread and the Pentecost and the Feast of Trumpets and Sukkot, all of these things. We look forward to them because we know that they are a shadow of things to come. You see, the people back in the Exodus didn't know that. They didn't know when they put the blood above the doorpost. They had no idea what did that mean. When they had to select a lamb for Passover and it had to have no blemish on it, it had to be a perfect lamb, they didn't understand that that represented Yeshua, HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, our Savior. It represented Yeshua, who was yet to come. That's what the lamb was all about. They didn't realize why Yahweh God wanted him to take it home for four days. Why take the lamb home? Because he wanted the family to get to know that lamb. They wanted them to get attached to it. Because then they were commanded to take that lamb to the temple to have it slaughtered, just as he had to give up his only begotten son to have him slaughtered for the sins of us. So he wanted them to know all of these things were prophetic signs. The whole Passover, the whole way it's set up, everything that they had to do was a prophetic sign. The blood above the doorpost was the blood of Yeshua HaMashiach over our heads, the forgiveness of sins, the angel of death passed them over, and there was no death for them. They will be resurrected to the resurrection of life. There will be a second resurrection, the resurrection of the dead, those who will be cast into the pit. And we know that if we read the book, if we read the Word of God. So all of these things are a shadow picture. And all of these things that we do, all of these feast days, they point to something. They point to something. And the fall feast days all point to his return. And we'll probably do a study on that as well. They all point to the Feast of Trumpets and a Feast of Atonement and Sukkot when he finally returns to tabernacle with us. All of these are shadow pictures of what is to come. The spring feast days were all about his coming. The fall feast days are all about his second coming. And we know these things. For those of us who study the Word of God and know these things, are well aware of these things. Those who do not, and those who are busy with football, basketball, 2.5 men, and American Idol, are a little short-minded. So, let's see here. Okay, I think we've been through that. I just wanted to keep up with my notes here because I had kind of a path I wanted to keep us on here. So, we've read these things in the book of Genesis where he's telling us very clearly sojourn in this land, and I will be with you and will bless you for you and your offspring. I will give all these lands, and I will establish oaths that I swore to Abraham your father. Genesis 28:14, of course, we just went through that. Your offspring shall be like the dust of the earth, he promises Abraham, and you shall spread abroad to the west and to the east and to the north and to the south. And you in your offspring shall all families of the earth be blessed. Let's just take a look at that. I've got this up. I don't know why I'm not showing you this while we're here. Go to Genesis 28:14. Here it is. Your offspring shall be like the dust of the earth, and you shall spread abroad to the west and to the east and to the north and to the south. And in you and your offspring shall all families of the earth be blessed. Behold, I am with you and will keep you wherever you go and will bring you back to this land, for I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. My friends, he's still fulfilling this promise. And how is it that these men of God, so-called men of God, do not understand that we are Abraham's offspring? Still today, they teach a separate church, apart, a Gentile church, apart from the Israelites. They teach this replacement theology that Christians have replaced the Jews. All of this because they only read the back half of the book. They don't read the first half of the book. They don't know that the plan from the very beginning was laid out from the beginning. It all unfolds from the beginning of the book. You've got to read the beginning of the book to see it unfold very clearly. I mean, just read this. You know, your offspring shall be like the dust of the earth, and you shall spread abroad from the west to the east, to the north, to the south. And in your offspring, all families of the earth will be blessed. In whose offspring? Abraham's offspring. And if we are in Christ, we're whose offspring? We're Abraham's offspring. How could you possibly teach replacement theology that the Christian church has replaced the Jews? This is ridiculous. It is ridiculous. But yet all day long, of course, you get this, the same guys that preach that Romans 14 is about changing the Sabbath. Same guys, same people. Okay, I just wanted us to read this. I also want us to take a look at 2 Samuel. Hold on here just a second here. 2 Samuel 7:12. Let's take a look at 2 Samuel 7 and 12. What does it say here? When your days are fulfilled, and when you lie down with your fathers, I will rise up your offspring. He's talking to David here now. Your offspring after you, who shall come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. Again, this is in 2 Samuel, and this is prophesied. This is prophecy about Yeshua, HaMashiach, Jesus Christ. Psalms 89:4. Let's take a look at Psalms 89:4 very quickly here. Psalms 89:4. Get it down there. Here we go. 89:4. What does it say? I will establish your offspring forever and build your throne for all generations. Yeshua HaMashiach. How about 89:35? Let's go down here to 89:35. What does it say? It says, once for all I have sworn by my holiness, I will not lie to David. He's talking about the prophecy we just read in 2 Samuel. He says, I will not lie to David. His offspring shall endure forever. This throne, as long as the sun is before me, he says. His throne, he says, let's read that again. His offspring shall endure forever, his throne, as long as the sun before me. Like the moon, it shall be established forever. A faithful witness in the skies, he says. Again, this comes directly from the promise that he made David. He said he was going to send Yeshua, who is in direct lineage of David. Let's take a look at Acts. I think everybody should probably know this one. I know that the Pentecostals love this candy stick scripture right here, Acts 2:38. Let's take a look at that. If you've ever sat in a Pentecostal church, you certainly know this one. And Peter said to them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is unto you, and to your children, and to all who are far off, even whom the Lord our God himself calls. He says, and with many other words he bore witness and continued to exhort them, saying, save yourselves from this crooked generation. My friends, if you have not made that decision yet, if you do not know who he is, please, please take the time. Take the time to go to your prayer closet, a place where you can be alone. Drop to your knees, face the east towards Jerusalem. Look into the heavens and ask him in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, to give you that Holy Spirit. Ask him to do it. Ask him to give you the discernment so that you can know the truth and that you'll be able to discern right from wrong, good from evil, and he'll give you that discernment. And ask him for the endurance to contend for the faith to the very end. And know and understand that this is the very first step in a very long journey that will take the rest of your life to complete. There is no such thing as once saved, always saved, my friends. That's why the Apostle Paul tells us in the book of Ephesians in the 6th chapter, he says, it's not the flesh that we battle. He says, it is these principalities in high places that we battle, these demons that we battle. It is a spiritual wickedness that we battle. And that's why he goes through the whole, the armor of God, the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, the sword of his word, the truth, the belt of truth, the shield of faith by which we can extinguish all the fiery darts of the evil one so that we may be able to stand in the evil day. We must stand, we must endure, and we must not shrink back. These things are what lead to salvation. Our Messiah didn't shrink back. Our Messiah stood strong. Our Messiah went through the persecution. And don't think for a moment that we will not just read the 24th chapter of Matthew and know and understand what he says is coming. Much of it already here. The birth pangs certainly here. We can see the wars and rumors of wars, kingdom rising against kingdom, pestilences and plagues like the bubonic plague and the black plague and chikungunya and now this new Zika virus and all of these things coming back up upon us again. Things that were ancient diseases from long hundreds of years ago are coming back. And we can know and we can understand that famine is all across the land. The animals across the world are dying in mass right now. So Fukushima has poisoned the West Coast. They have dead animals that are just coming up on the beaches and animals that are distorted and animals that have two heads and looks like human feet and all these things. Scientists can't figure out what all this is. It's distortion from the radiation. We can know what it is. And still to this day, Fukushima plunging hundreds of tons of radioactive water into the ocean every day. And all of these animals are now dying off. Why? Because the poles of the earth are now shifting. And we know that the poles of earth are shifting. These animals can't find their way. These whales are beaching themselves on the shores. Dolphins are beaching themselves. Sea lions, starfish, all kinds of animals. They've lost their way. Magnetic north is no longer magnetic north because the poles are shifting. The word of God says that Yahweh, God the Father, would turn this world upside down. And that's exactly what he's doing. And you can call it global warming, call it whatever you want. And I'm sure that probably plays into some of it. But we can know and understand why all these different weather patterns are taking place all around the world. We are living in the end times. Luke 12:56 tells us very clearly. In fact, let's go read it. Luke 12:56, what does he say? Let's see here. Let's get down here to the bottom. He says this. And let me start. Let's start right here at Luke 54. He said to the crowds, he said, when you see a cloud rising in the west, you say at once a shower is coming. And he says, so it happens. He says, when you see a south wind blowing, there will be scorching heat, you say. And it happens. He says, you hypocrites. You know how to interpret the appearance of the earth and sky, but why do you not know how to interpret the present time that you're living in? And why do you not judge for yourselves what is right? You see, this world can't judge for itself what's right anymore. We've lost our compass. We've lost our way because we do not keep the greatest commandment, my friends. We just certainly do not keep it. With that being said, my friends, I just want to thank you once again for sticking with us, especially on this very crazy Seventh-day Sabbath that we have had here trying to get up for our live event. We're going to try and get that fixed for next weekend. But we're so glad that you guys are with us and that you stay with us and that you share these videos and like these videos and download these videos. These videos are free to everyone. And that's why we do them. That's why we take the time. That's why we study and share, is so that you'll have them, whether you agree with them or not. You can download them, take them to Bible study, talk about them, tear them apart, put them back together again. We simply ask that you take what we're saying to prayer. Take these things to your prayer closet. And again, fall to your knees, face the east towards Jerusalem, and pray to Yahweh God the Father in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach the Son. And ask for that endurance and ask for that discernment, and he'll give it to you. This is not something magical. It's not something that you have to go to Harvard for or anywhere else. My friends, the Bible was not written for the astute. It was written for God's people. It wasn't written for the rich who go to colleges. It was written for the poor and the downtrodden. It was written for you and for me. That's who it was written for. And he wants us to understand it. And we can understand it. If we just ask him for the discernment, he'll give it to us. He will give it to us. In the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, my prayer is that the grace and the peace of God would be with you and that God's hand would be upon you for your protection until we meet again. We probably will not have a Bible study this Wednesday night. We are going to take a break. We are going to be starting on the book of Acts. We have some technical problems here that we need to get through here. So I don't think that we'll have that Wednesday night Bible study this Wednesday, but we will have it the next Wednesday, beginning on the first book of Acts. And you won't want to miss this because we're going to talk about the introduction. This is where the Christian church begins, the book of Acts. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are done. And Yeshua has now his death, burial, and resurrection is over, and the apostles now are moving out into the world now. He's come back to them, he's talked to them, he's trained them up in the way, he's opened their minds, and now they're moving out to start the brand new Christian churches and to explain to everyone how we are all grafted together into that olive tree. And he explains, and Paul will explain to us more about the law. We'll understand much more than we did in the book of Romans. And now that you know the book of Romans and you've been through that, you will much more understand the book of Acts when we go through the book of Acts. It is a wealth of information. I beg you to please join us for that study, the book of Acts. It's huge. It's absolutely huge. It's where it all began. After the Messiah leaves us, the apostles spread out and they begin the work that he sent them to do. So please don't forget that. Don't miss that. In the meantime, God bless you. Thank you so very much for sharing your time with us here. And we will see you on the next Seventh-day Sabbath, if not before. We may have that Bible study out if we can get these technical problems fixed. But if not, for sure, on the next Seventh-day Sabbath, we will see you hopefully live on Friday night. God bless and shalom.